Vážený pane ministře, chceme vyzvat vám a vládě České republiky se svou angažovanost s promocí lidských práv na půdě samozřejmě na té světě. Queremos agradecer al canciller y al gobierno de la República Checa por su activo compromiso por la promoción de los derechos humanos en Cuba y, por supuesto, en el mundo. Pime, vendi doce, chotos nominados, pero chamices que republiqui voy por dictatorismo. Viste chica, pero lo ve chefo de democracia. Sabemos muy bien lo que significa para los ciudadanos checos la lucha contra el totalitarismo, y la República Checa es un excelente ejemplo para la transición pacífica de las democracias. A pronto se me puede pedir a la actividad y a Fernando Diplomatics por iniciativa. Es Tito Simón. Y queremos entonces agradecer y apoyar la activa diplomacia checa con este reconocimiento.
Muchas gracias. Because, to be quite honest, I don't think I deserve it. Because I had just a lot of luck in my life. And if you have a lot of luck in your life, you should get a prize for it. Because the luck was enough. We had, admittedly now, being a rather ordinary man, and of course, the fates of my country, which were described, of course, made an impression on only the child. If you, the child, with your sister and your brother locked in your rooms far away, then you are looking out of the window because the Gestapo was coming to my parents and asking some questions. And of course, the parents were afraid that the children could speak too much of the truth, so that was one of my early children especially. And then again, when the Germans lost the wars, and for a moment liberty in my country was, and then the communist coup d'etat, and then again when we were afraid for our parents, it was a communist political police. Then we had the luck again, we left the country in December 48, roughly 9 months after the communist coup d'etat, went to Austria where I lived then for 41 years, quite happily, studied there and everything, and which gave me a great chance of life. But again, it was more by luck I came into the fight for human rights. Of course, I was interested. I was very much interested in what was happening in the Soviet bloc and what was happening around in the world and so on. And then, I don't know if you know the origin of the Helsinki Declaration for Human Rights. After the Helsinki Treaty was concluded, signed as by the Soviet Union, the United States and the European States, which permitted the first time that one could ask about human rights in a country. And it was permitted not only the citizens of its own country, but of course they were first. And there was a very courageous Russian group who started it. Some committed citizens, some of them have died a long time, some died still in a camp, and some are still living, few of them. They founded a group to watch the human rights in Soviet Union. Of course, they immediately got to the prison and so on, and one of them died, Marchenko, still in a camp. But this example was given. And suddenly there were new groups in Norway, in Sweden, in Germany, in Holland, all over the world, in Italy and so on, with the same purpose, watching human rights. And the duty of each human rights group, Helsinki human rights group, was first to work at home, first to watch human rights violations in your own country. That's the important thing. And then to get involved in other countries too. After some years, they decided it would be maybe better if they would work together. And of course, because then the main human rights violation in Europe were in the Eastern Bloc, in the Soviet Bloc, and to a high degree in Turkey. So they decided, and Austria was a neutral country, Vienna close to the Soviet Empire's border. So they decided to have the new federation's headquarters in Vienna. And they went to the then Chancellor of Austria, who was a great European Social Democrat, Mr. Kreisky, and asked him if Austria would mind, because they were a neutral country. He said, no, as long as you are only involving in human rights, that's okay for me. And then they chatted together, then they asked him, do you have a, we need a figurehead in Vienna who would represent us. Do you have a suggestion? He thought for a moment and said, probably will laugh at my suggestion. I have a suggestion. And to the utter astonishment, he named me. He said he's one of the few who knows really what's happening behind our party. So they came to me and they asked me if I would work with them. I said, yes, but I won't like to be only a figurehead if I get fully involved. And so my engagement started, and it fascinated me after some time. And then I went to all these Soviet countries and so on, and we were rather successful. Our main job was, because there was this great conference of cooperation integrated in Europe, which was in Vienna. First it was in Madrid and Belgrade, and then it was in Vienna. And we supplied all the missions of all the states, from Canada to Switzerland, and Italy to Norway, with all the news what's happening, where violation of human rights. And we, of course, what was happening then in Soviet Union, what was in Bulgaria, what was in Turkey, what was in the Czechoslovak Republic, Poland. But of course, we said that because it was a country which was parting in the conference too, we, of course, managed to use how many still executions were in the United States. So we were as a neutral, but very exact. And after some time, all these missions there, the whole year, Europe and North America were represented, took our information material serious. They realized that with some small errors we committed, they were hard facts. And then suddenly we realized that even some Soviet bloc countries read it regularly, and some realized what was reported in their own countries was true, and somewhere it was already, the regime was not as tough as before, reacted, the Poles, the Hungarians, and so on. And one day, to utter surprise, we got the invitation to the Soviet Union. And we went to Moscow, we met with Sakharov, who was not only courageous, but a very wise politician, wonderful man. And then we started the dealings with the Soviet establishment, with the party, the Central Committee, and so on. It was a fascinating job. Well, that's how I got into this whole human rights business. Just by chance, by luck. But it fascinated. And it was hard work already then. Then suddenly, by implosion, the Soviet Empire tumbled. I remember we had just the election of the new Czechoslovak president, Václav Havel, on the last days of December. But the next day I had a rush already to Vienna airport, because I had to go to Romania, because the revolution in Romania started. So I landed suddenly in the midst of the revolution in Bucharest. And help the first protect the child. So I get involved. But then, of course, there's a bitter moment, and when President was elected, he asked me to work for him. When the head of state asks you, and especially if the country just a month ago became free, and you have to change the whole world, you have to change the whole country, you can't say no. And so I said, of course, okay, I will do that. Start to work in the office, sent my own business in, which was mainly lost a bit of it in Germany. From now on, I will be less present, try to work without me, which we quite successfully did. And of course, but then came the moment we had an iron rule in Helsinki Federation of Human Rights. If you become part of an administration, you have to step down in the Helsinki Federation of Human Rights. And I had to step down as chairman because I became member of the administration. And as I told you, the first duty is to be watchful in your own country, because it's very easy to criticize the circumstances of a faraway country, and sometimes even in a neighbor's country. It's difficult at home to do. So I stepped down, and then I was working as a chancellor for Bahar Sabha. Then I had to work for some time for my own business, but was still in touch with the human rights movement, took sometimes part in a mission. For the first time I was then in Belarus, which I am now working again, but was foreign affairs, with everything in Belarus. But then I got elected to the Senate in the Czech Republic, and then of course as a politician I had the chance again to work on human rights, and I got even more involved. I went once in Cuba, which was very interesting for me, and had a lot of meetings there, traveled the whole country. It's a wonderful country with wonderful people. Hardly ever in a country where people were so friendly. On the road, on the gas station, on a pub somewhere deep in the countryside. Hardly I saw ever so friendly people, but very poor. But then the police detected that I'm in the country. They fetched me in the hotel, brought me on state expense to the airport, and sent me with the next plane back to Europe. So that was the end of my Cuban stay, lamentably. But I still had the chance before to meet the most important dissidents, or the wives of those who were then in prison, which gave me enough material for my further work, where I could realize how similar the Cuban regime was to our former regimes in the Eastern Bloc, what were the differences. And well, and then, with my political career, it's not as so important, suddenly I became Minister of Foreign Affairs, and then there was again luck, because since Václav Havel was president, we started in 1990, and died a month ago, late Jerzy Dinsmir, who was the first Minister of Foreign Affairs against the Czechoslovakia. It was a founding stone of the new foreign policy of Czechoslovakia, then immediately Czech Republic, the defense of human rights. Of course, naturally, especially as a smallish country, what the Czech Republic is, we can't be fully engaged in the whole world.